Good morning, Upper East Siders. Today I have a very special video. As I'm sure you read the title of the video, this is going to be a full analysis of the Gossip Girl lore, seasons 1 and 2.
And who am I? That's not a secret I'll never tell. You know you love me. XOXO, Gossip Girl.
This is a video I've been waiting to make for multiple months now. I've been planning it since before Christmas because this is a topic that I deeply am very knowledgeable about. I've rewatched Gossip Girl at least 6 times. I'm in the middle of 2 rewatches, one with my sister and one with my roommate Paris. I love Gossip Girl. XOXO is all I have to say about the matter. So of course, I'm wearing my cutest little dress with a bedazzled bow on it. And puffy sleeves like I know Blair Waldorf in 2024 would love. And I'm drinking cranberry ginger ale with little berries in it because I'm a teenager who's going to pretend to be drinking alcohol at a bar legally. Because that's exactly what the Upper East Siders of Gossip Girl do. So let's get into it. I have made a 25-page analysis of basically every season of Gossip Girl, and I'm not even done with season 6. So, with that being said, this is going to be very in-depth. Who knows how long this video is going to be? So you've probably heard of Gossip Girl through the internet. Maybe you watched it when it was on TV. Maybe you've watched it during the, you know, great 2020 renaissance of Gossip Girl, when it had to do with literally every TikTok trend that was going on, like the Thanksgiving get-up, the headbands. So much was happening on the internet that had to do with Gossip Girl that people didn't even know how to do with Gossip Girl. Okay? Joe Goldberg of You theories about it going back to Gossip Girl. Penn Badgley is booked and busy, and people are still relating it back to Gossip Girl. That's how iconic it is. It will forever remain a part of our pop culture. Okay? So much iconic stuff come out of Gossip Girl. TikTok trends, Thanksgiving episodes, fashion trends, insane celebrity guest appearances. Like, don't even get me started with the crazy amount of celebrities that popped up on Gossip Girl. It's definitely 100% famous for toxicity, crazy plot lines, the toxic rich kid lifestyle, the lifestyle that everyone wants but can't have, but everyone hates. Like, you hate these characters, but you love to watch what shitty stuff they're gonna do. Like, it's so interesting. Also, of course, Kristen Bell's iconic Gossip Girl narration will forever remain in my brain.
Welcome back, Queen Serena. Consider us your humble servants. Because if looks could kill, we wouldn't want to be Dan Humphrey.
So if you don't know, Gossip Girl started off as a book series by Cecily Von Zagsar. I'm pretty sure is how you say her name. Her first book was published in 2002, and it is a set of 13, and surprisingly, I've not read a single one of these books. The TV show aired September 19th of 2007 on the CW network. Pilot description is the privileged prep school teens learn that Serena Vanderwoodson is back in town. Who is Serena Vanderwoodson? Well, we'll get into that in a little bit. But the setting of the show is in New York and Manhattan. The characters are all Manhattan's elite and people who wish they were Manhattan's elite. Of course, the show deals with socialite society, rich kids, rich adults, people wanting to be rich kids and adults, the relationships of these rich kids and adults, and all of the troubles that they get into. You want to be them, but you also despise them. It's a perfect storyline that keeps you coming back for more and more. It's really, really easy to get into the show because it's just such a chaotic plot that you want to learn more and more about, and you want to know what these characters are going to do to ruin their lives. It is forever fascinating and forever iconic. The entire show is narrated and pushed along by this persona called Gossip Girl, played by Kristen Bell, the narrator. She, of course, came back for their spinoff series, Gossip Girl, which premiered in 2022, I think? This Gossip Girl persona publishes and posts online about the private lives, the secrets, the public lives, and everything you want to know and don't want to know about these super rich kids in Manhattan. And of course, all the trouble that they stir up, all the disasters that happen, and some things that aren't disasters and just should not be posted about on the internet. Gossip Girl is the original. She's the OG. Gossip Girl is the OG. Okay, TMZ wishes they were Gossip Girl. Of course, this show deals with a lot of stuff, including but not limited to relationship drama, everyday whereabouts and locations of these characters, the sex lives of teenagers, death, outing people publicly, drug dealing, forging federal documents, identity fraud, mental disorders, and as you can imagine, a bunch more. Okay, there's literally 6 seasons of drama, toxic relationships, healthy relationships, sort of healthy relationships, really questionable choices, amazing fashion and costumes. It is an insane, insane show, and the CW, like, was really boosted because of Gossip Girl. It brought in a whole new demographic of viewers and teenagers and interests. There are 6 seasons of this dramatic, heartbreaking, chaotic show. And of course, there's 121 total episodes, so you have plenty of entertainment options when it comes to Gossip Girl. There's 88 hours and 37 minutes total of Gossip Girl, and I've watched all of them multiple times. The main characters of the show are Serena, Blair, Nate, Chuck, Dan, Jenny, Eric, Lily Vanderwoodson, Rufus Humphrey, Dorota, and then Bart Bass. Those are all the main characters that I feel like mentioning right now. Of course, as the seasons go on, we'll add more characters in, but those are the main people of season 1 and 2, and specifically season 1, episode 1. You get those characters introduced to you in the pilot, and they're kind of brought in as like, these are going to be your main people that you really need to worry about. Everyone else is just a side character to help move it along. So the groupings of the show remain pretty consistent throughout the entirety of the 6-season show. You have the core 4, which are Chuck, Nate, Blair, and Serena. Of course, the group will go through like friendship issues and such, but pretty much the core 4 is a thing throughout every season. You then have the Humphreys, or the Brooklyn gang, which expands as the seasons go on. But starting off, it's Jenny, Rufus, and Dan. The Humphreys sort of remain consistent. There's, you know, family issues and such. We'll get into that in later videos when it actually comes up in the seasons. Then we have the Vanderwoodsons, which at this time are Serena, Eric, and Lily. Of course, there's a little bit of debacle about the Vanderwoodson family, and there's a lot of interesting storylines that play into that in later seasons, but of course, those are later seasons. Then, last but not least, we have the Waldorfs and Dorota. The Waldorfs and Dorota are basically just Blair Waldorf, Eleanor Waldorf, Blair's mom, and Dorota, Blair and Eleanor's housemaid, and Blair's sort of, like, lady. Like, she's pretty much raised Blair her entire life. She takes her to school, she makes sure all of her needs are met, and Blair almost has another parental figure when it comes to Dorota, but also a sister. Dorota and Blair's relationship is really strengthened through the show, and there's a lot of times that the show, like, highlights how close they are, and I feel like season 1 you don't really get to see a lot of Blair and Dorota, but later you do. Season 1. So it premiered September of 2007, and it concluded in May of 2008. It consists of 18 episodes total, making it the shortest season in Gossip Girl. But just because it's short does not mean it is not super juicy and chaotic and amazing. So every character in Gossip Girl is given a nickname by Gossip Girl herself. For example, Jenny is Little J, Blair is Queen Bee or Bee. The main plot of season 1 is the disruption of Manhattan elites, like their teenage lives, by Gossip Girl going in and gaining popularity through exposing them and their secrets, and of course their whereabouts, locations, like what they're up to. It also is the entire premise of the show. Season 1 just sets that up very, very well, because I think that season 1 is a very good first season of a show. I also think that it establishes like relationships very well and like how hard it is to maintain privacy when you're already like in this high society of Manhattan and then have people publishing and posting about you all the time. The premise of the pilot is that Serena is coming back into town to rebuild relationships while pre-established relationships are crumbling. And of course, the Humphrey family is pushed into this mix of Manhattan's elite by Dan and Serena bumping into one another and meeting and making up a fake date scenario to cover for Serena. So I'm just gonna go in and break down each character from the start of the season. So we'll start with Serena Vanderwoodson. So Serena in the pilot comes home from being away for an unknown reason that no one's really talking about. And then of course, it's revealed that she's come back to New York to support her brother, who has been admitted into a institution because he tried to hurt himself. It's also revealed that Eric felt really lonely since Serena was there and their mom has been very distant. They don't have a good relationship with their mom and their dad isn't around very much. So it's revealed that, you know, Eric and Serena pretty much relied on one another and then Serena disappeared and things started to crumble, not just for Eric, but for our next character, Blair. So for Blair, I think that she has like all of these things going for her perfectly. She's pretty much painted to be this perfect girl in Manhattan elite society. Her mom is a fashion designer. She has this picture perfect long-term relationship with her boyfriend. And her biggest goal in life right now is losing her virginity. Yep, that is the Blair plot for episode one. That is how Blair is introduced. Then we have her picture-perfect boyfriend, Nate. Nate Archibald has a perfect relationship with his long-term girlfriend, or so it seems, because he's keeping a really big secret, and all of episode one, he's super weird and, like, just not good vibes from Nate at all. Nate is this picture-perfect boyfriend of Blair's. He comes from a super rich family. His father is an investment banker, I think. And then his mom comes from a super long, rich line of politicians. Nate is doing pretty well for himself, or so we think, until we find out he's got some weird secret that he's been keeping. Next, we have Chuck, who is pretty much just, like, the bad boy of the group. Like, literally the bad boy of the group. Super shady. Basically does drugs and drinks all the time. He's very, like, weird and touchy and, like, gives you the creeps. Especially in the pilot episode. Chuck is literally just in general a fucking creep, all right? He's this crazy rich boy who's really let the power get to him and he doesn't care that what anyone thinks. He's quite literally drunk with power and he kind of just like is supposed to be part of this friend group, but you don't really see him interact with anyone in the friend group the entire episode. Next we have Dan, who is a newly introduced character to this group and he is the so-called lonely boy from Brooklyn. He catches the eye of Serena Vanderwoodson, and he's pretty much just seen as, like, this mysterious, like, awkward guy who doesn't really have experience with people like Serena. Everybody else that I mentioned first is basically a side character, and, like, we'll talk more about them later, but these five characters remain very consistent throughout the show. Like, they are, like, there, and the other characters, not so much. So we'll talk about them when their plot lines come up. All right, let's talk plot for season one. The first main plot point of the season that I want to talk about is Serena and Blair's friendship, because it kind of starts off and there's this weird tension and they're both like, oh my gosh, you're my best friend. And then like Blair makes a few comments that have a tone to them. And it's about like this.
Blair, think we can meet tonight?
I'd love to, but I'm doing something with Nate tonight.
The palace.
8 o'clock?
Nate will wait.
Spotted on the steps of the Met, an S and B power struggle.
We'll probably do a half hour.
Did S think she could waltz home and things would be just like they were?
Thanks for making the time.
You're my best friend.
So you can see how there's a bit of tension there. Second plot point that remains very prominent in season one is Nate and Serena's secret. They're both very secretive. Serena's disappeared for the entire summer, and Nate has been really weird and standoffish with Blair since Serena disappeared, and then when it's announced that Serena's back in town, he's super weird. Another plot point for season one that goes throughout the entire season is Blair's sexual identity crisis. In episode 2 or 3, I think, Blair breaks up with Nate because it's revealed that Nate has slept with Serena, and that is the reason that everyone believes Serena left at the beginning of the summer, which is crazy. And then we get this crazy little thing.
What's wrong?
Look, I don't know how to say this. It's even the right thing to do. But, something I need to tell you.
I do not have it right now.
You worried Nate will find out?
What?
Last year, the Shepherd wedding. I think I don't know why you left town.
I know it! I always knew there was something! Get out!
Yeah. So then, she gets into this, like, weird crisis where she's kind of like, she doesn't know who she is without having a boyfriend, which is something she really struggles with throughout the entire series. And I think that's really interesting. Throughout all of season one, she struggles to like find herself without the validation of others, and she realizes that doesn't really work for her. She then like is desperate to find and seek a romantic relationship, and she finds that validation in none other than Chuck. Yeah. So we also get to learn a little bit more about Blair's life before season one starts. Like at the beginning of season one, you're kind of like, oh, like this girl's like kind of a bitch. Like kind of don't like her because she's mean to everyone. She's mean to Serena for no reason. Like her boyfriend cheated on her, but like maybe he was right to do so because of what kind of person she is. But truly you learn that Blair has been through a lot. You find out that Blair's been recovering from an eating disorder for a few years. You find out that her mother is very particular about her image and who Blair presents herself as. We also find out that Blair's father left her when she was 15 after coming out as gay and having an affair with a man. He then flees to France, away from New York, leaving Blair alone with her mom and her, you know, very distant boyfriend. And, of course, we also find out that that happens right around the time that Serena leaves town, so that's really unfortunate for Blair. Now let's talk about the weird best friends that are Chuck and Nate, because as the show starts off, they have scenes together and you're like, oh, like obviously Chuck and Nate are best friends, and then like, do they even know one another? It's just weird. It's almost like they're best friends because, you know, they are both just rich and their families are friends and that's kind of all they have, and they don't really act like best friends at all. Okay, especially after Nate and Blair break up, and then Chuck invites Blair to his burlesque club, and then Blair does a burlesque performance for Chuck, and then they have sex in the back of Chuck's limo. A few hours after Nate and Blair just broke up. I could go into the relationship drama of Gossip Girl in an entire another video. But basically, you find out that throughout this entire season, Chuck is literally just trying to seduce Blair, and he's struggling to be a good son, which I feel like they could have led more with the whole, like, Chuck needs validation, and Chuck has been seeking this validation from his only parental figure his entire life, because I think that that would have made Blair and Chuck's relationship stronger and more supported by the viewers if they had seen these similarities between Chuck and Blair, even though they weren't together at the time. You find out that Chuck has been dealing with a lot of abandonment issues by his father, and that he's like, mother's out of the picture. In episode one, it said that his mother like does drugs, but then episode 2 or 3, it's revealed that his mom died, and like, whatever, it's fine, okay? They try to, like, fix his character and, like, make him better and give him an arc, but it sort of works. I feel like in season one, the only real storylines he has is trying to, like, repair his relationship with his dad and then trying to be, like, this perfect guy that Blair wants, but also he's like, you don't want a perfect guy, you want me. Another major plot line in the show is not just Serena and Nate's secret, but Serena's like literal like baggage claim of secrets that she brings with her when she comes back to New York. So I'd like to call this the Georgina Sparks effect, and it's kind of when Georgina Sparks, a character that we have not met yet, when Georgina Sparks shows up, everything kind of goes to shit, and shit is definitely stirred up amongst the characters. So in about the middle of season one, Georgina Sparks, this unlike you don't see her but you hear her name, is brought up a few times, and everyone is like pretty much struck with fear and like worry. They don't really know what's going to happen about this Georgina character coming in. I think this is probably a big plot point for Serena, and it's what I think one of the most interesting plot points for Serena. And after it, they kind of didn't know what to do with Serena's character, which is unfortunate. When Georgina comes to town, it's revealed that Serena and Georgina are responsible for killing someone. Yeah. Well, they think they are. Really, this man had an extreme drug issue and he ended up overdosing, and they didn't realize that he had an extreme drug issue. So Serena has gone like a year believing that she's killed this man, and that's why she really ran away. Not because she felt bad for sleeping with Nate, but because she thought she killed a person, which is arguably worse. To some people, I don't know, maybe that's an unpopular opinion. You also find out that Serena has been having such a hard time with Georgina coming back because Georgina's blackmailing her with a sort of sex tape, murder tape, that she filmed with a hidden camera in their hotel room. And then Serena's mom sees it. But she doesn't watch the whole thing. She just thinks it's a sex tape. So that's really unfortunate. The season ends with Bart and Lily's wedding. And the night before their wedding, Lily and none other than Rufus Humphrey. That's right, guys. Dan and Ginny's dad. Rufus Humphrey and Lily get together the night before her wedding. And it's really crazy because then you're like, oh, well, of course Bart and Lily aren't going to get married. Well, you would think. You would think. But they do get married, and Bart knows that Rufus and Lily have spent the night together, and he's like, you need to let him go, and then we'll get married. And she's like, okay. Yeah. Throughout the course of season one, Dan is pushed more and more into this Manhattan elite lifestyle because he's dating Serena. And by the end of the season, they break up because of, I don't even know why, okay? Like, I could not articulate why, because their relationship was pretty, like, meh the whole entirety of season one. They have a few really cute, sweet moments, like their first time that they have sex together. Serena's like, no one has ever looked at me the way that you look at me. And I find that really special. And I think that was really, really sweet and really nice. But some weird things that we find out about are like the fact that Lily and Rufus used to be together, and Rufus is also still married, and his wife is like having an affair, sort of, but they're still like, they're separated, but they're together, but like they're together enough for it to be an affair. It's very interesting, okay? But by the end of season one, Dan and Serena have decided to break up, and it's really quite sad because they're at Bart and Lily's wedding and their wedding reception, and they are like told to dance together and get pictures together. And it's like this really, really sad moment between the two of them, and they're like, I can't believe like this has to be over, but like it has to be over. Another thing that we get to see is we get to see like Nate, Chuck, and Blair's like weird back and forth with one another. Chuck and Blair sleep together, and then Blair and Nate almost immediately get back together. She then has sex with Nate also, and then Gossip Girl exposes her for sleeping with two men in the same week, and Nate's like, it's not true. And then Ginny's like, no, it is true, and she's butting her nose in. And this is where my hatred for Ginny comes from, because like, yes, I understand, but at the same time, like,
Who are you to come and stick your nose in people's business? And then we see this weird, like, tension between Nate and Chuck, and then, like, they're all of a sudden, like, friends again. It's also revealed that Nate's dad has been, like, addicted to drugs, and he blames Nate when his mom finds them, which is, like, a really good parenting lesson to learn. And then Nate ends up getting his dad arrested for, you know, doing drugs. And then they find out that Nate's dad's actually guilty for tax evasion. And so that's crazy. I think that it's really interesting how in season one, the plot points, like, turn not just towards the teenagers, which is how the show kind of starts as, but you learn a lot more about the parents. You learn about Lily and Rufus's relationship. You learn about Rufus and Allison, his wife. And we learn a lot about the parents, and I think that helps see why the kids are the way they are. And it gives them a bit of redemption. It gives them a bit of, like, oh, wow, like, I like your character because I understand why you do this, why you act the way you do. And I think it's really interesting to see how the characters all evolve and grow off of one another. Another interesting thing to see in season one is that Serena's struggling with this changed person that she is now, and she's struggling to relay that to the people around her who don't see her as a changed person and will always see her as this troubled party girl that she was before she left, which got her into situations like sleeping with Nate and like being there when that guy overdosed in front of her and Georgina. It's just really interesting seeing season one, how these characters are struggling with their own things and they're like so young. I think it's a very interesting take. Another thing that happens throughout season one is that Nate is kind of just like in the loop, ends up being this like good guy for how good he can be, as you know, he cheated on Blair with her best friend and like blame, whatever, okay. He also kind of struggles with this, like, mentality of, do I save my dad and my family, or do I do the right thing and report my dad and have him face the consequences of his actions? And he ends up choosing the right thing. He does choose to, you know, have his dad arrested for drug dealing. It turns out to be a way deeper issue, but it shows you what kind of character Nate is. And I think that's really interesting, and it's interesting because he's so different from the other characters. In the friend group every season, that really sucks that he's, like, the good guy, or, like, he's kind of put as, like, a background character. Because I think that there's so much depth that you can have with Nate. I really do think that his character in season one, like, allows for this storyline of, like, he doesn't really know who he is, he doesn't know what he wants to do with his life. And then that storyline pretty much remains that way for the rest of the show. As for, I think, the top side characters that we meet, like, throughout season one, we have Carter Bazin, played by Sebastian Stan, who's, like, he used to be part of Manhattan's elite society, and then he's, like, become this sort of, like, breaking out of the norm, and he's, like, a traveler, but really he's just an addict and, like, obsessed with being rich and successful. We also meet Georgina Sparks, who I talked about, who I think Georgina is such a well-written character. I really do. I think that she's very consistent. She comes in, she stirs up drama, she leaves, okay? Like, that's what she's brought in to do. She knows her purpose. She does it. She loses herself a few times, but it's okay. She always bounces back, and Georgina remains an interesting point in the characters' lives, and she's pretty much always stirring up something when there's nothing to be stirred up. She brings up old secrets, she reveals things, or she comes in and she's like, hey guys, guess what? Two other characters that we have are Cody and Iz, who are Blair's minions. And they don't really have, like, personalities other than being Blair's minions and being popular at school. But we do get a really, really fun storyline of them searching for, like, this new queen, this new, like, leader, because Blair kind of falls out of this, like, leader aspect. Jenny kind of takes over a role in the group, and it's just very interesting watching it all unfold. And last, but I guess not least, another side character we meet is Vanessa Abrams. Don't even get me started on Vanessa. I think Vanessa is a good addition to the season. I do. I think her character makes sense. She comes in after, like, being away. It's revealed that Vanessa and Dan are best friends, and that right before Vanessa left, Dan revealed to Vanessa that he is deeply in love with her. And Vanessa pretty much was just like, cool. Bye. Which is so crazy, because then she comes back, Dan is now with Serena, and she's kind of like, I actually did want to tell you that I love you too. Anyway, so then we see Vanessa kind of struggle with being Dan's, like, one tie to Brooklyn now that he's in Manhattan's, like, society. We also see Vanessa go through, like, a weird relationship with Nate for some reason, whatever that's about. And it's kind of cute. They're kind of cute. But also, like, Vanessa is the epitome of, like, your boyfriend's girl best friend. Okay. She's like, I don't like your girlfriend. I've been your friend longer. I actually know you better. Hey, girlfriend, if you need help, like, let me know, because I know your boyfriend way better than I. Like, you're annoying. You're annoying. And Vanessa's character annoys me, and there are very few times that she pushes the plot along, but when she does, it is fun. When she does, it's good. Okay? Like, she has proof that Chuck and Blair had sex. And she dangles it over their noses and is like, no, like, you guys are just terrible people. I'm not going to give you this. I'm not going to use it. Like, you guys are terrible people and suffer the consequences of your actions. And it's just interesting. But yeah, I'm going to die on the hill that Vanessa Abrams is annoying. Like, I don't care. So now I'm going to do something, and I'm going to tell you my top 5 episodes of this season. So starting at number 1, I have Blair Waldorf Must Pie, which is episode 9 of the show. It's the Thanksgiving episode. So if you don't know what a Gossip Girl Thanksgiving episode is, basically every season of Gossip Girl sticks to one holiday, and pretty much one holiday only, and that is Thanksgiving. And one theme that is consistent in these Thanksgiving episodes is that every dramatic plot twist you could think of comes out in this Thanksgiving episode. Dramatic twists and turns, and people are upset because it's the holidays and they just don't know how to relay their emotions, and it's so fun and fascinating. And something I love about the season 1 Thanksgiving episode is that you get flashbacks of this Thanksgiving and the last Thanksgiving of the last year, where we didn't even know these characters yet. So we see Serena as this crazy party girl. She's super drunk. It's 10 in the morning on Thanksgiving. Blair's going to save her. Dan, of course, tries to save Blair and Serena, and Blair's like, you're disgusting. Get away from her. We then get to see Dan's family dynamic before his mom left, which is pretty interesting, I think. Seeing them in this, like, more fresh kind of light of, like, oh, like, this is what they were like before their parents had so much drama and tension. And then we also get to see their new family dynamic and, like, the current day part of the episode. I also think it's interesting, you get to see, like, Nate and Blair's relationship dynamic a year ago and what they were like and how they were, like, super close. Nate, Blair, and Serena were super, super good friends. We also see Blair's dynamic with her dad, who we, like, don't really get to see and talk about in season 1, other than the fact that he's gay and is no longer in the picture. I think that the Thanksgiving episode of season 1 sets up the characters very, very well. It shows you how much these characters changed within the year and, like, the tensions that are brought about at the beginning of season 1. It makes a lot more sense. I really like how it sets up Thanksgiving episodes for future seasons. For my number 2 spot on my top 5 of the episodes is Desperately Seeking Serena, episode 15. Desperately Seeking Serena is when Georgina comes back into town, and I think that the gossip stir up and, like, dramatics of it all makes it such a fun episode to watch, and it really brings about new plot lines that you're like. For my 3rd top episode of season 1 is High Society, episode 10. So as you can imagine, High Society is a debutante ball and the girls and guys in these families coming out into society at their debutante ball, which I think you get, like, 2 other debutantes episodes in the show. If I'm not mistaken, I think you get at least 2 others. And I think it's just so much fun. I think this episode is also stirring up drama. You kind of see this weird tension between Nate and Chuck, and then like Carter Bazin, and like Chuck is kind of stirring up drama, and he's like, oh my god, like, you never believe what Carter said about Blair. And then Nate gets defensive and he's like, that's my girlfriend, like, I love her. And then Blair's like, and then Blair and Nate go and have sex, and Chuck is like, whore, slut. And it's just so funny and interesting. And then, of course, we get this iconic clip from this debutante episode.
Daughter of committee member Lillian Vanderwoodson, granddaughter of chairwoman emeritus Celia Catherine Rhodes, escorted by Carter Bazin. Miss Vanderwoodson hopes to bend as many billionaires as she can before settling down to... Oh, my God. Sorry.
You also get to see a little bit of tension between the parents, because this is when Dan's mom comes back into the picture, and you see this weird tension between Allison, Rufus's current wife, and Lily, his ex-girlfriend, and like the weird tension that they have there that no one's really understanding just yet, because their relationships of past haven't been revealed to the kids yet. Or my fourth favorite episode in the season is episode 2, The Wild Brunch. This episode is so good because it also showcases these teens at the very beginning of the show, and like how they live their lives, how they talk to one another, how they talk to their parents, how they like go about their days in society, and it isn't just setting up the premise of the show. It's really nice because you also get a feel of who every character is like a person. You see Serena's this reformed bad girl. She's trying to make herself into this new light, and she's dating this loner boy from Brooklyn. You also see Blair as kind of disapproving of Serena's image and disapproving of pretty much anything that she doesn't come up with by herself. And for my fifth favorite episode of season 1, I have episode 6, The Handmaiden's Tale. In The Handmaiden's Tale episode, it is, of course, like, insane. And that is why it is one in my top 5. The kids are at a masquerade ball, and of course, Blair is trying to win back Nate at this point. She sets up this like scavenger hunt for him to go on, and if he finds her by midnight and unmasks her, they get to have sex that night, which doesn't happen because Nate gets sidetracked, and he kisses Serena, which is actually Jenny, because Serena gave her her mask. As for my final thoughts on season 1, I think it is an amazing first season of a show like Gossip Girl. It sets up these characters very well. It sets up their storylines, their lives. It introduces new characters, and I think that a way that a lot of shows can't do. It handles a lot of like real teenage issues like eating disorders and seeking approval from your peers constantly, and it handles them in a way that makes it seem so like insane to even think about that people of this standard and lifestyle could have those issues. But it really allows you to see each character for who they are, and I think it sets up for a good rest of a show. And I think that's why it was renewed so easily after season 1. Let's talk season 2. So season 2 premiered September 1st, 2008, and its first episode is titled Summer Kind of Wonderful. This season has 25 episodes, making it the longest Gossip Girl season, and it's arguably my favorite season. So you may ask, what have the characters been up to this summer, and what are they up to in the first episode? So Serena and Nate have spent all summer in the Hamptons, which is where you find out most of Manhattan's elite spends their summer. They've been pretending all summer to be in a secret relationship that's been posted about by Gossip Girl, although they've never been seen together. We find out that Nate has been with this married woman who is like twice his age, which is really interesting. After the storyline, a YouTuber called Friendly Space Ninja put it perfectly and said, if Gossip Girl were a stage play, Nate Archibald would be a tree. Pretty much meaning that he's always there in the background and like has a purpose, but you're not really sure what it is. You also find out that after season 1 ended and Dan and Serena broke up because he didn't want to be part of that lifestyle, that Dan has basically had a slutty little summer. All of his character progress is basically thrown in the garbage. I think season 1, Dan is pretty interesting, and you get to learn a lot about him. And, like, you know, he writes, except for he doesn't really know what to write about because he doesn't really know who he is. And then in season 2,
he really takes a turn for the worst, and he truly adapts into this Manhattan elite lifestyle that he's been so against and was so like adamant about not being a part of in season one. You also find out that Blair was left by Chuck. Chuck and Blair were supposed to go to France or somewhere, whatever, together. And you find out that Chuck basically abandoned her, didn't contact her all summer. And so Blair basically took it upon herself to find a new romantic interest over the summer to make Chuck jealous. She comes back with this guy who's like, okay, he's fine. And then we find out there are a few gaps in his story, and it makes like Chuck a little suspicious. Like, where did she really find this guy? Then we also see that Chuck is literally just the exact same asshole that he started off as in season one. You know, all that's changed is that he's now like romantically drawn to Blair, even though he like broke her heart at the end of season one and left her. Then we have Jenny and Eric, and I put them in the same pod for season two because their plot lines are very intertwined throughout season two. So in season two, Jenny and Eric are back to being friends after the pilot episode where Jenny has been working under an internship at Waldorf Designs all summer, and she needs an in at something called the White Party. Of course, her dad comes up with the idea that Eric and the Vanderwoodsons probably have like an invite to go, and that Jenny should talk to them about maybe being a plus one. So Jenny ends up asking Eric for an invite to this white party. Their friendship issues are kind of resolved. They both apologize for being bad friends to one another in the first season. And then when Jenny goes back into school, they have a lot of their issues are pretty much dealt with together. And so I'm putting them together at the start of the season plot. As for plot points that go out throughout the rest of season two, Blair's guy that she's brought back from her vacation with her has become really suspicious and secretive, and like Chuck and Eric have kind of caught him in a few lies. But Blair's like, it's okay because she is just using him as a cover, and she actually hates him, tells him that she finds him annoying and boring, and then it's okay because he reveals that he's a British royal. Unfortunately, at the end of the White Party, Serena and Dan do get back together, which is really unfortunate. I also think that Serena, like, I'm fairly sure Serena goes on to, like, date some artist guy who's connected to Dan because his art is at his father's gallery, and then that, like, makes things weird, too, because Dan's like, oh, you're dating that artist guy, but, like, I know. And then it's like, as for Chuck Bass, he basically tries to seduce Blair the entire season, being like, you know, you still want me, I'm Chuck Bass. And what's crazy is Blair gives him a little ultimatum at the end of episode one, and it's like, you know, three words, eight letters, say it and I'm yours. And he's like, and then she's like, okay, thank you. And she leaves. And then he's like, why'd she do that? Well, it's because you didn't say that you loved her, and she literally asked for one thing and you couldn't do it. I think that Blair asking Chuck to say that he does love her is not asking too much. She's like, for us to actually go through with a relationship, I need you to prove that I mean something to you, that you value me. And he can't even say it.
Which is crazy.
As for side characters that we meet Catherine and Marcus Beaton. Catherine Beaton ends up being the woman that Nate has been seeing all summer, a married woman who's very, very rich and wealthy. She's the Duchess of somewhere. And her stepson, Marcus Beaton, who is the revealed to be Blair's royalty boyfriend. Then we also have Poppy Lifton, who's like this superstar kind of person who Serena befriends, and she ends up walking an Eleanor Waldorf show. Then we have Cyrus and Aaron Rose. Cyrus ends up being a love interest for none other than Eleanor Waldorf. And then we are also introduced to his son, Aaron Rose, who is the artist that Serena dates. And last but not least, we're introduced to Agnes Andrews. And what are the plot twists of season two, you might ask? Oh, there's plenty.
In season two, Ginny goes full on grunge, angsty teen, and she partners with a model, Agnes Andrews, who we meet to then create her own fashion line. She quits her internship at Waldorf. She drops out of school to make this fashion line. She basically runs away from her family and disowns everyone. Her and Agnes create this full fashion line, and they sabotage a benefit that's honoring Bart Bass and Lily Vanderwoodson, now Lily Bass, for being philanthropists. It's honoring them, and like we're giving this big award. And J. Humphrey Designs crashes it with a fashion show. It's called a guerrilla fashion show. Ginny and Nate sort of have a thing, but then they don't. And then it's revealed that they don't have a thing anymore because Nate wrote Ginny a letter, and Vanessa hid this letter from Ginny. Well, Ginny finds out, and she wants revenge. And so, at something called the Snowflake Ball, Ginny says she made Vanessa a dress, when really it's just the overlay of a dress, and it has no lining under it, and it's just this really see-through, sparkly material, to where if you don't wear anything under it, you can see literally everything. Well, she gives it to Vanessa, embarrassing Vanessa in front of literally everyone. Then we see the group of seniors, and they're all doing, like, senior year college things. Serena gets invited to Yale personally. She gets a handwritten invitation, and she goes to Yale because her and Blair are fighting, and then, of course, they fight some more in front of the dean, and it really embarrasses Blair, and then Blair embarrasses Serena by bringing up the guy that she sort of killed, and then Serena's like traumatized, and they go outside and they physically fight, and a lot happens, and then they make up very soon after. Blair's mom remarries and ends up marrying Cyrus Rose, who is this lovely man that I was talking about earlier, which is a very rushed storyline, but also it makes sense, and it like really allows for Eleanor to change from where she was in season one as Blair's mom. And the season ends with the gang's graduation, and Gossip Girl releases this major blast about the graduating class superlatives. Nate is the class whore. Dan Humphrey is an insider on the outsider, and he'll always be on the outside. That Blair Waldorf is actually an insecure wink link, and she's not a leader at all. That Chuck Bass is really a coward. And Gossip Girl then claims that Serena Vanderwoodson is officially irrelevant. Oh! As for the biggest plot twist of season two, Bart Bass dies in a car crash. Yeah. Chuck Bass's dad dies in a car crash after it's revealed that he has, you know, spent all this time with a private investigator, and he has research files on literally every single person in his family, and Lily gets really upset about this, and is kind of like, you know, I don't want to talk to you until the Snowflake Ball, and he's like, all right, fine, I'll come talk to you at the Snowflake Ball. Well, then Lily gets a call that Bart has died in a car crash, of course ruining, you know, the night. It brings the core four closer together to try and help Chuck. It brings the Vanderwoodsons together to try and get Chuck to be part of their family still, and he's, you know, thinking that Lily has cheated on Bart with Rufus. I think that it's also a really good episode, Bart Bass's funeral episode, where afterwards Chuck kind of disappears. They can't really find him. And then Eleanor and Cyrus get married, and it's revealed that Chuck is upstairs waiting for Blair. And I think it's a very sweet moment that he has that sort of vulnerability with Blair, and he doesn't know what to do. All right, so now we're going to go into my top five episodes. Starting at number one, my favorite episode of the season is episode 13, Oh Brother, Where Bart Thou? This is the episode of Bart Bass's funeral, and it shows Chuck dealing with the struggles of being alone. It deals with his friends kind of trying to put him back together and his family putting him back together, and it's a very interesting thing you get to see. You also get to see Dan and Aaron fighting over Serena, and that's also really weird because, like, Aaron is her boyfriend and Dan is just her friend, but she's kind of finding more comfort in Dan, which is interesting to look into. My second favorite episode is Goodbye Gossip Girl, episode 25 of the season. It's the season finale. I think it's really fun because the kids are graduating from high school, they're leaving their past selves behind, and Gossip Girl puts out one final blast during their high school graduation. And it's just so fun. It's just a fun closure to the season. And it really shows that Gossip Girl is in control here.
My third favorite episode of the season is episode 6, New Haven Can Wait, and that's when the kids go to their respective schools that they want to visit, and of course most of them, all of them actually, end up at Yale. Serena ends up at Yale because she's trying to get back at Blair for some nasty things that she's said and done. And of course it turns into a really dramatic brawl between the girls, and the guys get in their own trouble, and it's just really, it's fun to watch because you kind of get a taste of their first bits of college and how they're still very immature and trying to play off as mature and more adult than they are. My fourth favorite episode is the Magnificent Archibalds, episode 11. It's the Thanksgiving episode and it keeps you on the edge of your seat. I'm just going to read the synopsis for it. Blair's favorite Thanksgiving traditions are ruined by her mother's new boyfriend. Serena doesn't tell Erin about her past, but Dan definitely does. And that episode, like, I just rewatched that with my roommate, and it keeps you on the edge of your seat, and you're kind of like, oh my god, oh my god, and you don't know what's going to happen next, and I think it's so, so very fun. And then it's revealed at the end of the episode that Blair's father has come to visit her, and I think it's very, very sweet. For my fifth and final favorite episode, I have episode 1, Summer Kind of Wonderful. I think that this was a great opener for the season. It was also really fun. And of course, the vitamin water white party, like, hello. There's then goes on to be a vitamin water sponsor throughout all of Gossip Girl. And I think it's so much fun. I love that vitamin water sponsored Gossip Girl. I love vitamin water. I'd love if vitamin water sponsored me. Like, what? That's so exciting and fun. I think that it's a good opener for this season, and it starts off very strong, showing you where the characters are and what they've been up to while we've been gone. Last, I have an honorable mention episode for the season, and it's episode 24, Valley Girls. This entire episode was like a flashback for Lily Vanderwoodson's character. I really enjoyed it because it's something different that, like, you don't really get to see throughout the rest of Gossip Girl. We'd only seen it once with the Thanksgiving episode of season 1, and this one is about Lily Vanderwoodson, and like, you don't really get to know a lot about Lily before this point, and I think that this is a good start of, like, knowing who Lily is as a person and, like, where she comes from, and I really enjoyed the episode. For my final thoughts on the season, this is probably my favorite season. I think I can say that very strong because I think that the acting is very good. I think the plot is done pretty well. I think the plot points keep you pulled in. The twists make you coming back for more. I think these are some of the best episodes of the show are in season 2 because, like, the characters just do so much for one another and you really learn more about who they are as people and how they react in situations, and I think that season 2 is done very nicely. All right, guys, that is the end of my first Gossip Girl lore analysis. I hope you guys enjoyed this video, and I hope to make many more videos like this in the future. This is just season 1 and 2, so if you want to get started on watching Gossip Girl, I recommend it now. It is available to stream on HBO Max and available to buy on YouTube and Prime Video. Of course, if you don't watch Gossip Girl, that's perfectly fine. Just keep staying up to date with these analysis videos, and hopefully there will be more to come. XOXO!